Hi there and welcome back. Let's review hydrocephalus today, also known as water on the brain, which is actually the CSF or the cerebrospinal fluid. And that is a clear liquid that looks like a water and is produced in the four ventricles or the cavities of the brain connected by narrow pathways. So hydrocephalus, water on the brain, commonly referred to as water on the brain because of the cerebrospinal fluid, looks like a water, a clear liquid, and hence the name is water on the brain. The body makes almost a pint of new CSF, and the amount of CFS is perfectly balanced, meaning not too much, nor too little. Hydrocephalus occurs when there is an imbalance of production and or absorption. With most type of hydrocephalus, the fluid gets trapped in the ventricles and cannot complete its circulation, usually due to a blockage. The excess fluid causes the ventricles to expand. As a result, pressure is placed on the brain at the skull, causing neurological problems. However, there are a couple of types in which there is an absorption problem, and they are benign external hydrocephalus and normal pressure hydrocephalus. So, hydrocephalus or the water on the brain may be either communicating or non-communicating. Communicating is the one when the CFS is able to flow from ventricle to ventricle and circulate in its normal procedure. However, the problem is one of reabsorption at the subarachnoid cisternae, also referred to as the arachnoid granulations. Whereas non-communicating hydrocephalus is caused by an obstruction within the ventricular system. Both communicating and non-communicating hydrocephalus can be subdivided into congenital and acquired types. One form of communicating hydrocephalus seen in infants is benign external hydrocephalus. The cause is unclear, but CSF flow studies suggest a disturbance in absorption. This condition usually corrects itself without surgery by 18 months of age. Another type of communicating hydrocephalus is normal pressure hydrocephalus. This condition normally strikes those who are middle age and older. The classic signs of this condition are dementia, incontinence, and a gait disturbance. Because the syndrome develops gradually and signs of increased intracranial pressure are absent, the diagnosis may not be made for a long time, and in many cases, the problem is misdiagnosed as dementia, Alzheimer's, or Parkinson's. Congenital anomaly, infection. Talking about the causes now, congenital anomaly, infection, hemorrhage, cyst, or tumor are the most common causes. More than 70% of all hydrocephalus cases are congenital, discovered during the mother's pregnancy, at the time of the birth, or soon after. Brain injury occurs every 15 seconds in this country, and in some cases leads to the development of hydrocephalus. There are approximately 75,000 discharges per year from hospitals in the United States with a diagnosis of hydrocephalus. So, what about the symptoms? The characteristic features are headache, vomiting, damage to the cranial nerve function, including visual disturbance, ataxia, and incontinence. Drowsiness and coma may develop. Treatment. The most common treatment for hydrocephalus is to use a shunt. A shunt is a mechanical device designed to transport the excess fluid or the CSF from or near the point of obstruction to a reabsorption site, and it is implanted under the skin. The shunt has three components. The first portion is called the shunt catheter or proximal portion of the shunt. This is a small narrow tube or the catheter which is implanted into the ventricle of the brain above where the obstruction has occurred. It is then connected to the valve and reservoir. The valve controls how much fluid is withdrawn from the brain. It is then stored in the reservoir until it is released to drain down the distal bottom end. This distal end is a small narrow piece of tubing or a catheter which leads to the point where the excess fluid or CSF will drain and be absorbed by the body. The absorption site is usually the abdomen or peritoneum. This is the preferred location for the placement of the distal end of the shunt. This type of shunt implantation is referred to as a ventriculoperitoneal or a VP shunt. The pleural or the lung cavity or ventriculopleural shunt, or the atria of the heart or ventriculoatrial or VA shunt can be used as well. The gallbladder or the bladder can be used, but this is only when there is no other site that is suitable. You should know that the shunt performs two functions. It allows to go fluid only in one direction, and the valve allows fluid to flow out only when the pressure in the head has exceeded some value, usually referred to as the opening pressure. This system regulates the amount of the fluid or the CSF in the body so that not too much is taken nor too little. Having a shunt is a lifetime commitment. Once a shunt is implanted, it is not a one-time operation. Life expectancy of a shunt averages 10 years. So how do we underwrite? We need to look out for, are we dealing with congenital or acquired? Shunt placement or revision? Or underwriting a case without insertion of a shunt? Are there any complications? Do we see stable normal intelligence, no epilepsy, and neurologically normal? Are these factors present or not? And bottom line, we correlate these details into our underwriting manual and our company specifics to arrive at the offer that we can extend within the parameters that our company has set. With that being said, let's stop here and see you soon. Take care.